WTBQ. Hello and welcome to ANGT Radio, America's next great trainer, 93.5 WTBQ, where we want to educate, motivate, inspire, energize, and empower you to be the best you can be, promoting positive, healthy, fit, active lifestyles. On one note, I would like to, being that we open up with, of course, Rocky's theme, basically to send out that message to never give up, that victory comes in the face of adversity when faced with very tough and challenging times. I was speaking with Sylvester Stallone's publicist today, and of course, unfortunately, Sylvester Stallone and Jennifer Stallone, their son had passed away, Sage, at a very young age. So our thoughts go out to the Stallone family. Sylvester Stallone has such a significant and great impact through his movies and his creativity. And I know personally that movie Rocky has had a great impact on my life. So again, my thoughts, or our thoughts and prayers, are with the Stallone family. On another note, on a positive note, I would like to speak a little bit about, again, sticking to Sylvester Stallone's movie theme of never giving up and pursuing that goal until you do face that victorious moment. And in this case, over in London, we have some great, great stories. And there was an article today in the New York Post by Mike Vaccaro that I would like to share with you. And it's about Missy Franklin, because these moments that they all strive for, you can only imagine the thousands and thousands of hours that go behind that one moment in time where they're standing up on that podium. And to think back and reflect on what went in to that moment, the amount of effort and energy and all the people involved, the coaches, the parents. And in regards to the parents, P&G has a great message. They have a thanks mom message that they send out during the Olympics, because mom bringing the kids to practice at a very, very young age and enduring all those years of sacrifice to share and to give to their children and to help them achieve their dreams. And in this case, we're going to talk about Missy Franklin. Missy, congratulations. Great role model. In the article by Mike Vaccaro, it's Miss America, Golden Girl Gives Proof Through the Night. So again, I would like to share this with you. I love the Olympics because it really does send out such a great message and a testament to the strength and the power of that one thing you do not see, the human spirit and that will to win, where they have to dig deep down inside, physically, mentally, totally exhausted, but that little thing pushes them over the top, over the edge, and that's where they're setting their world records, and that's when they reach that point of standing on that podium. And, of course, I can't even imagine that feeling as that flag is being raised and the feelings and the emotions, not only in the individual, but the family members as well. So again, back to the article by Mike Vaccaro. The first batch of lyrics came easily, but so did the first sigh, which interrupted Missy Franklin right as she reached the part about the twilight's last gleaming. She picked them back up easily by the perilous fight, but suddenly you can see the smile twitching and her eyes blinking, and she needed to exhale. The podium was purple. The warm-up suit was gray. The medal around her neck was gold. A rainbow of victory. Missy Franklin wanted to keep up with the words, the first time she's ever sang them from the tallest stage in her sport. She tried. By the time the bombs were bursting in air, it was too late. I wanted to sing, she said, but I started to cry at the same time. And then I forgot the words. 32 years on, we remember Mike Urizioni as much for the way he sang the Star Spangled Banner with gusto on a medal stand as we do for the goal he scored against the Russians two nights earlier. This, after all, is the moment for which these athletes spend lifetimes training. They may not have to endure the squalor in which their predecessors lived during the days But this is still the biggest payoff, a medal around the neck, an anthem blaring out of loudspeakers, a flag raising before them, positioned just a little bit higher than Australia's and Japan's. With everyone back from watching, we will watch Missy Franklin from here. You bet. She guaranteed that last night, her night, and these could well become her Olympics. Even if she doesn't take down the Phelpsian Hall, we will remember how she climbed out of the pool after qualifying barely for the 200-meter freestyle, then jumped back in for the 100 backstroke finals exactly 13 minutes later. Later, no less, a source then, Michael Phelps, would say, "I can't believe she did that." And then she was magnificent. One lane to her left, Australia's Emily Seebohm was poised on the bar. All Seebohm had done in qualifying was set an Olympic record. Franklin is too young and too accomplished at 17 to know the symptoms and the perils of pressure. But this was it. This was her moment. "I've waited all my life for this," she would say, realizing at once the sweet irony, adding all of 17 years. This already has been an intriguing meet. Phelps' meltdown in the 400 meters Saturday. Ryan Lochte's meltier meltdown anchoring the 4x100 Sunday. And then yesterday, in the wake of China's blistering win Sunday in the women's 400 meter, her final 50 meters clocked even faster than Lochte's in the men's race. Raised eyebrows were given a voice from John Leonard, executive director of the World Swimming Coaches Association, who called Yee's feat flat-out impossible. Here came Missy Franklin out of tragedy-stricken Aurora, Colorado, and Regis Jesuit High, skimming through the pool, keeping up with the Aussie stroke for stroke, off to a faster start than normal because she had to be. Here came Franklin, putting her 76-inch wingspan, the size 13 feet, to perfect use, reaching the wall, finally touching it, .35 ahead of Seebohm. The smile came the moment they glanced at the scoreboard. It never left for even a second the rest of the night, not even during the national anthem, especially not then. When you dream about something your whole life and you achieve it, you don't understand what you just did, she said immediately after the race, her words coming in a rush, giggly, girly, and to borrow her favorite word, awesome. "I just won an Olympic gold medal," she squealed. "It's exceeding expectation by 100 million times." Yes, we will watch Missy Franklin from here. We are a cynical sporting lot, and with reason, and in many ways we need to watch her. She's already turned down boatloads of cash and endorsements and prize money because, no kidding, she wanted to keep swimming at Regis and in college. She is having the time of her life, letting us ride shotgun, letting us stand beside her on a purple podium, laughing, crying, sighing, rejoicing, forgetting the words when it all becomes too much. Having the time of our lives. Missy Franklin, congratulations, and what a feeling that must be. All of those years, those thousands and thousands of hours for that one moment in time. And one of the most powerful songs I can remember from the Olympics goes back to Whitney Houston and One Moment in Time. And those words were so empowering because the bottom line is these Olympians, these athletes, since basically the time they started to walk, they began this journey leading to this moment. So I would like to dedicate this song to all our Olympian athletes out there by Whitney Houston. And again, these words are so powerful. And we're behind you. Go USA, go America, and let's take a listen.
Me, I'm only one, but not alone. finest day is yet unknown. I broke my heart for every gain to taste the sweet. I face the pain. I rise and fall, yet through it all, this much remains.
Powerful, so very, very powerful. Whitney Houston, One Moment in Time, and the words just so meaningful. And as I said earlier, those moments that they strive for, that one moment in time, and key words. And of course, I'm a big believer in the power of words, thinking carefully before we actually use words, especially in regards to our youth. Because it's so very important, positive reinforcement and making positive, healthy choices. But in one moment in time, the answers are all up to me. And we all have those answers inside us. We just have to dig deep and we have to make a plan. We have to realize what is it that we want and then go for it. We can all be our Olympian very, very best. But it's just a matter of that commitment, when you decide that you're going to do it, you're going to commit, and you're going to stick to that commitment. You're going to make a plan and do whatever it takes to get it done. Another one of the great coaches that I always admired, Vince Lombardi. Vince Lombardi had great words, and in his in a book from way back, this game called Life, Words of Courage and Inspiration from the World of Sports, Vince shares his words, and this pride wins. Coach Vince Lombardi knew victory as few men do. He preached dedication. He preached hard work and sacrifice. And every year, Coach Lombardi told his squad just that, pride wins. I've never been with a loser, gentlemen, and I don't intend to start at this late date. You're here to play football, and I'm here to see you play as well as your God-given abilities will allow. And that means total dedication. I want total dedication from every man in this room, dedication to himself, to the team, and to winning. Winning is a habit, gentlemen. Winning isn't everything. It's the only thing. If you could shrug off a loss, you can't be a winner. The harder you work, the harder it is to lose. And I'm going to see that you work. I'm going to push you and push you and push you because I get paid to win, and so do you. Football is a violent game. To play, you have to be tough, physically tough and mentally tough. And you got to have pride, because when two teams meet that are equal in ability and execution, it's the team that has pride that wins. Gentlemen, let's be winners. There's nothing like it. And right now, on that note, another great coach, mixed martial arts strength and conditioning coach, and also a positive role model to his clients, we have with us on the line, Chris Miller. Chris, how you doing?
Hey, I'm doing good. How you doing?
Good, thanks. Are you catching some of the Olympics?
Yeah, a little bit, man. I've been on my grind so hard, man. I've been catching a little bit, and you know, when I'm able to watch it, I was watching like water polo, you know, things like that.
powerful stuff, I tell you.
Yeah.
Just which we can relate to being trainers and coaches when you see these young athletes pursue such an amazing feat, being the best in the world, and then those thousands and thousands of dedicated hours striving for that one moment in time. It's just an incredible, incredible thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
So what's going on in your world? Tell us how the training's going, how your clients are going. Are your clients reaching their goals, their personal best?
Yeah, man, things are going good, man. I just ran a Living Social deal. I'm sure you guys are familiar with Living Social. It's like a Groupon. You guys have that up there? Up in New
York?
Yes,
yes.
Yeah, so I ran that, had about 70-some people that bought the deals, and so they've been coming to my boot camps, and I didn't really want to call it boot camp because I sort of got away from calling it that boot camp, so I just call it strength and conditioning, and my class has been pretty packed. Matter of fact, I got like 10 people in the gym now, but I got another guy just running, filling it in while I'm outside talking to you guys. So it's good. My clients are, you know, it's been a pretty hot summer down here in Maryland, so we've been in and out, flipping from being out in the park a lot to inside the gym. So it's definitely losing some weight and losing some inches, more importantly, and just enjoying it, man. They changed their lifestyle. I got people in here that haven't worked out in months and, you know, even years, so they're getting reacquainted with, you know, the workout aspect of life.
Let's talk about when a person comes to you, when a potential client comes to you, what do you find is basically the number one goal? Is it to lose weight, or is it to, with that comes feeling better? But I mean, basically, is the first thing they say to you is, I want to lose weight, I want to lose 10 to 20 pounds. Is that what you find most often?
Yes, that's the biggest thing, and I always try to tell everybody that comes through the door, or whether I'm talking to them on the phone, I haven't met them yet, and say, hey, stop worrying about what the scale says. Worry about how your clothes fit, and even more importantly, how you feeling, because, you know, that people get caught up in how much people weigh, and shouldn't be caught up in just your weight. You need to be worried about how you're eating. You need to be worried about how your clothes are fitting, because, you know, if you walk in and you're, 180-pound, person and you ran a 40 waist, and you may be, you know, in a month you may be 175, you only lost 5 pounds, but you're down to, you know, like a 34. So I think that's huge as far as just, you know, losing the inches and feeling better.
Do you provide them with nutritional advice?
Not from a standpoint of, you know, writing out plans. Like, they'll ask me, what do I do, and so forth. And I'll recommend, you know, a variety of things, since I'm not, you know, I'm not a dietitian. I mean, I have a certification in sports nutrition, but at the same time, it's like I'm not at liberty to say, okay, you know, sit down, let's break it down for you. I just sort of say, hey, this is what works for me. This is what I use. This is how I eat, and so forth.
Well,
and
so you give them your recommendations for starting their starting them on their way to losing, say 10 to 20 pounds.
Right, exactly.
What's a realistic goal for someone wanting to lose 10 to 20 pounds in regards to weeks?
I come
to you, I say, Chris, I want to lose 15 pounds in a month. Do you find that reasonable, achievable?
It all depends. If it's somebody that if somebody's just sitting there and hasn't done anything in months and only can commit to 2 days a week working out in general, then I say, no, that's not a realistic goal. Let's shoot for 1 to 2 pounds a week, and which is, you know, theoretically 8 pounds, you know, anywhere from 4 to 8 pounds a month, which I think is a safe way to lose. So 15 pounds in a month, that's kind of tough. And to keep it off for the next month is even a bigger challenge.
What do you recommend your clients train at when they're first, say someone comes to you, basically a sedentary lifestyle, they've worked out before, but they let themselves go, they've gained quite a bit of weight, but they want to get right back into it fairly quickly. How would you, or what would you do to recommend how many times a week that they should be training?
Training with me, I tell them, people, you know, 3 days a week and on your own, you know, I would probably say for the first month, at least 5 days total, they should be, you know, working out. And not only, but when I say work out, I just mean they're actually moving, doing some things. So they may be working out with me Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and then Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, Sunday, they could be out there walking. They could go walk the lake. They could walk the path, go get on the treadmill or the bike and so forth like that on that side, where, you know, versus hardcore weights and, you know, getting your heart rate up to a certain level. But I try not to tell them to jump in super heavy, because that's how a lot of people get injured.
Do you find that for weight loss, traditionally it was always 60 minutes of cardio, because you're not going to start burning fat for the first 15 to 20 minutes. So sick, we need you on that treadmill for 60 minutes. Do you find now personally, through as training has evolved, that, you know, this interval training and power circuits are really very, very effective? Do you find them more effective as opposed to just your typical 60-minute, say, treadmill? You put them on, say, a 20 to 30-minute interval training?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I'm super huge on intervals. I mean, I've been interval circuit training. I've been big on that for years. And, you know, I don't know one person that likes to be sitting on a treadmill for an hour. You know, if you set up 6 to 8 exercises and you go through the circuits and then you may jump on the cardio afterwards for 20 minutes and, you know, because you're going to be working double time after going through a circuit for 30 to 40 minutes. So I definitely recommend circuits, because not only, I mean, you're burning, you know, you're getting your aerobic and anaerobic work in doing your circuits versus just sitting on the treadmill getting your aerobic work in.
Right. I think that right now, well, we can educate the listeners or people that are not familiar with intervals of circuits. What Chris just mentioned, basically, you can pick out six, I would say the same number. That's a good number to start out. Yeah. If you're thinking about getting on a workout program, something that could be short and very, very effective, you pick out about six exercises. Then you do each exercise for a certain number of repetitions. I would advise, you know, doing fewer repetitions just to get yourself through the circuit the first round, and then you repeat that circuit, say, 3 to 5 times.
Right.
And that will get someone off to on some sort of track to the next level of training, which could be increasing the repetitions, increasing the degree of difficulty in the exercises. But it's very, very simple to get them started on a circuit. And you could do that at home. You don't have to leave the house. You could just create your own exercises, squats, push-ups, lunges, lunge twists, you know, whatever it is, just pick out those few exercises and then incorporate that into a routine yourself.
Right, absolutely.
Let's talk about, I know that you mentioned, you know, we spoke briefly, but I always like to talk a little bit about food, because that basically, you know, their weight loss does start in the kitchen. And if that's not working together with their workout programs, you know, they're not going to have the results, the really reach that potential that they could ultimately achieve. So let's give an example, and then you can jump in, of course. Instead of these things that I'll mention, you know, I'll say try this. Like, for example, you find a lot of people that may be eating croissants, biscuits, white breads, and rolls. Instead of having that, they could put substitute low-fat whole grain breads and rolls, wheat, rye, and pumpernickel, as opposed
right,
to that.
Right.
But making those small substitutes, and a bigger one is like donuts, pastries, those things. Definitely, you know, you can substitute things easily for that, because that's just loaded with sugar.
Yeah, absolutely.
And those are the places that you really need to cut back. So when a person
right.
comes to you, do you put them through an assessment? You put them through an assessment and evaluation, especially for those people that have not been trained for a while, so you want to sort of know where they stand physically.
Yeah, absolutely. Definitely an assessment. I'll run them through, you know, just a exercise for each body part to see where they are from a physical standpoint, and then I'll ask them. But even before that, I'll sit them down, you know, obviously run through all the health questions, and that I'll ask him or her, how have you been eating? And I'll recommend them keeping a food diary for like that first week, just so they could sort of get adjusted to keeping track of everything they eat, as well as being on point to their exercise and so forth, versus just, you know, not being honest. Because a lot of people, if you tell people, hey, you know, keep track of what you're eating, a lot of people just try to cheat and just write down all the healthy things. So I try to tell them, hey, just act like I never even asked you to do this and just write down everything you eat.
It's very, very important, because then it's right in front of you. You see what you're taking in on the course of a day-to-day basis. And then that's where you can really put those substitutes in. And it's not too difficult to find out healthy substitutes. You can go to websites. You can go online and just fill in those blanks. But those high calorie, especially those snacks, or when you're really binging, you know, you cut back, you'd be surprised how, not you, but I mean people, that it's not even a matter of really getting to the gym right away. It's just a matter of
right.
making those small little cutbacks in regards to their eating habits. So
yeah,
else? You train many mixed martial arts competitors, Chris?
Yeah, man. Two of my pro guys just had a fight. They actually fought on the same card 3 weeks ago up in West Virginia, and you know, we were victorious up there. Went up there and we're 2-0. And my one guy, Dan Root, that fights down here on Shogun, he actually beat a guy that only had three losses, and his only three losses were three guys that are in the UFC right now. So that was a big win for him. And so we were pretty hyped up about that. And then another guy, he's a younger guy. He's 24, and he fought, this was his third professional fight. He took about a year off, and he won 1:32 in the first round. So that was pretty big win for him, getting those cobwebs out of him. And so that's going pretty good.
Now, when you train the fighters, do you specifically stick to the strength and conditioning? Are you actually doing the skills and drills, or are they pretty much doing that elsewhere, and then they're coming to you for the strength and conditioning?
Yes, they're just coming to me for the strength and conditioning.
Strength and conditioning. So basically, because I know that when you and I were down in Miami, down there with JC, awesome, awesome coach and instructor, amazing, JC Santana, at the Institute of Human Performance. That was just an incredible experience.
Yeah, definitely. I learned a lot from that piece. And matter of fact, I'll be down there next week, taking the wife and kids down there. So my brother only lives like 5 minutes from where the gym is, so I'm going to try to pop in there probably Thursday or Friday, say what's up, and see what they're up to.
Oh, make sure you tell them I said hello. That's for
sure.
Yeah,
definitely, man, definitely. But it's been huge, man. The whole mixed martial arts industry, man, and just younger kids, the whole generation of yeah, where this sport's going, it's just big. And even if they have the dreams to get to UFC and they don't get there, they still going to have that discipline instilled in them to, you know, go to these schools and learn this mixed martial arts, whether it's whatever discipline, jiu-jitsu, wrestling, stand-up, Muay Thai, kickboxing, and so forth. That's going to instill that discipline in them. So I'm pretty excited about it. I mean, I can't wait till they legalize it up in New York so we can get some things shaken up there.
I think that will that's bound to happen. The question is just when. But back to the mixed martial arts, I think right now there's a certain stigma. Back when I studied martial arts or karate, you know, especially parents, they would want to enroll their children basically for the discipline, the respect, and the values and the confidence building that it provides.
Right.
And then on top of that, it's a form of fitness and the great benefit of self-defense, which
right.
for kids, especially when they have that knowledge of self-defense, that's self-confidence. So I think what parents have to really understand today, when you see a mixed martial arts on a school, you know, I think the first thing they think of is fight. They think of that word fight, and that's what it is. It's a fight, but basically, you know, it's still the same values that when I was younger, are instilled in the children through martial arts. It's just that it taglines mixed martial arts because the kids get in such great shape and they learn self-defense, but they're still instilling the values. My only concern or my only word of advice to parents especially is when going to martial arts schools or mixed martial arts schools is to make sure that you sit through a class and watch the instructor and also ask, who will be teaching my children or my child?
Right.
That's very, very important because you don't want to be going there for three introductory classes and have a super, super instructor who you don't see for them. But mixed martial arts, I strongly encourage parents to get involved in martial arts or mixed martial arts, but it's a great form of fitness, self-defense. And today, especially with the bully situation, the bottom line is we as parents, myself included, whether a little boy or girl, all children should have the knowledge of self-defense and learn how to fight. And I think it also builds up their will and their spirit to never give up, which, of course, is in line with the martial arts, you know, that never give up attitude. And you could apply that throughout your life.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. Self-defense thing is definitely big because, I mean, I have two daughters and a son. And, you know, I want them to learn how to defend themselves. You know, it's a cruel world out here. Kids are cruel and, you know, kids are mean. And, you know, I'm the type of person where, you know, growing up in the 70s, 80s, it's like if somebody's bothering you, you know, you're not going to back down. You're going to punch somebody in the face or something. But nowadays, it's a lot of legalities behind it. But at the same time, it's like, hey, if somebody's bothering my daughters, let alone, you know, my middle son, I want them to defend themselves. You know, first thing I'm going to tell them is, hey, just walk away. But if somebody put their hands on you, then it's a different type of party out there because, you know, now they're disrespecting you and they're violating you. And, you know, I want somebody to be able to, I want them to be able to defend themselves. And if we walk up to the school and we're talking to the principal, I'm going to say, hey, this person's been bothering so-and-so for X amount of months, and they put their hands on her, and she defended herself.
Well, in a couple of next week or the following week, we'll be having a friend of mine and also a very big advocate, and he's involved in the school system up here, Travis Jackson, and he has a tremendous anti-bullying. He's always educating the kids about cyberbullying and anti-bullying and the solutions. And, of course, another good friend of mine who actually has a program coming out on MTV, Mark Wilkes, I think in August, Omega Man, they call him. So,
right.
Again, these programs are great. So, Chris, in closing, where can people find you? I know you're in Maryland, but online, do you have a website they can go to?
Yes, sir. They can go to www.maxfit.net, and that's maxxfit.net. They can also find me on Facebook under Maximum Fitness, and or they can reach me on my cell phone, 443-864-7236.
Well, as always, Chris, I do hope to catch up with you down there in Miami. Maybe stop by the Institute, IHP, Institute of Human Performance, CJC. And that was a great workouts, great experience, lots of knowledge. But I look forward to speaking with you again. And thank you very much, Chris, for joining us. And I'll talk to you soon, brother.
Yes, sir, Rob. Thanks for having me on the radio. I appreciate it.
All right. I'll talk to you soon, Chris.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Chris Miller, great instructor, great leader to all his clients. And again, empowering people because, as I said earlier, basically I think the trainers, the great trainers, are not only training their clients physically, but they're also they're hitting them mentally and emotionally and even spiritually to give them that attitude to never give up, never quit, to push yourself to the next level. So basically, life transformers. That's what the great trainers, I believe, are doing today. And it's such a much is so needed right now in today's, where we are today as a society and as America as a whole. You know, so you get caught up in thinking of all the negatives. But on the positive notes, back to the Olympics, everything comes down to choices and the choices we make day to day, making healthy choices and making things happen in our own life. To make something happen, you have to make that commitment to yourself. You have to dedicate and you set enough, whether it's breaking a habit like smoking, which I highly recommend that you do, not only for yourself, but for the sake of your children. I don't know how many people I know where their children are begging their parents to stop smoking because they understand and they know, they see the commercials that, mommy, daddy, you're killing yourself, please stop. Well, you know what? Make that commitment to yourself. Your life will be so different. You'll feel so much better, so much healthier. But again, it comes down to choices, the healthy choices that we make day to day. You can break habits. You can change. It's all that power that comes from within and making something happen. And again, one song that sticks comes to mind in making it happen, the tune from Mariah Carey, Make It Happen. So sit back, take a listen, and we'll be right back. Make a good choice. Make it happen.
Keep on going. And if you get down on your knees at night and pray to the Lord, he's gonna make it happen. Make it happen.
Make it happen. ANGT Radio, 93.5 WTBQ. Bringing out the best in you. And it all starts with how you fuel your body and how you live your life day to day. Another great song by Mariah Carey, Make It Happen. The words are so powerful. The key words. How do you program yourself every day? What key words or thoughts do you let manifest within yourself? And when you listen to Mariah Carey's song or Whitney Houston's song, so powerful, you know, words like faith, believe in yourself, and that life can get tough, and you're going to feel like giving up. But you have to believe within your soul. And that's where these Olympic athletes, they reach down within their heart, their spirit, to bring out the very, very best. And they always face challenges, just like every one of us in our personal lives. We're always facing challenges, always facing many, many obstacles. They're going to be there all the time. And well, not all the time, but hopefully less of the time, but they will be there. And it's how we handle those situations and what you let consume your life. When you make a list, you can make a list of the positives and a list of the negatives. But for some reason, human nature is you could have 100 things that are going right in your life, and you could have those 3 things that are wrong. And you'll let those 3 things consume and just bring you down, and you'll dwell on them, and you just won't seem to get yourself up and out. But you have to find that place that you say, you know what? These are the things I want to focus on. These are the things that I choose to focus on. So again, going back to keywords, it's like you punch in those keywords in the computer. Program your mindset with those positive thoughts and those positive keywords. And again, fueling the body the right way, eating the right foods, leading a positive, healthy lifestyle. And in saying that, there's a wealth of information out there, of course, on the internet. You know, when you're feeling down or you feel like you want to get on a workout program, make it a habit to listen to programs, to read, and of course, great magazines, Muscle and Fitness Magazine, Men's Fitness Magazine, Shape, provide a wealth of information, including their websites. They have great websites that give you all sorts of different workouts and supplement recommendations. So again, just going over the scanning through the websites, you can pick and choose different workouts, different programs, just to get you started. And even for the advanced athletes on the muscleandfitness.com website, for example, you have Jim Stepani, amazing strength and conditioning coach and trainer. He provides great videos so you can see exactly how to do the exercises and correct movements. So again, check out those sites. And also, now, you have Star Magazine and OK Magazine, mainly known, of course, you have a lot of gossip out there, but they provide great information because a lot of people, they see the celebrities, they're always looking good, they're always looking great. So what are they doing? So as I was breezing through OK Magazine here, we have some tips on how the stars shed some weight. And I'm looking here at Jennifer Hudson. She has an amazing transformation. She lost 80 pounds, and she says that is due to her Weight Watchers program. So again, making those choices and then making the commitment. And then we have Heidi Glum. Basically, Heidi, she does a lot of running, and she attributes her physique and her attitude towards life to her personal trainer and her summer runs through New York City. So again, it's all what you choose to do throughout the course of the day, and some healthy tips that I can share with you in losing weight and toning up, you know, just some general tips. The best thing I find is, especially if you're trying to lose weight, is to do cardio first thing in the morning. And again, depending on your fitness level and what you pick and choose to do. But if you're just starting out, I would suggest a 30-minute power walk at a brisk pace. And then if you're beyond that, or if you want to try something different, again, you can go back to those interval exercises, challenging yourself, picking out 6 to 7 exercises, and then doing, say, 10 repetitions of each, taking a 1 to 2 minute rest, and then repeating that for 3 rounds to 3 to 5 rounds. So again, you could do a 30-minute walk, 30-minute power walk, 30-minute jog, or you can mix it up with a 30-minute interval first thing in the morning, because then you'll start burning that fat right away. Number two, smaller, more frequent, healthy meals. Snacks throughout the course of the day, no big meals. Preferably after 5 p.m. if you're really trying to drop the weight, because the later it is, the worse it is. Avoid starches, white bread, and pastas. Three, of course, plenty of water. Try to avoid all those sugary drinks, especially the sodas. Four, get in the habit of reading nutritional labels and what to look for. How much sugar? You will be amazed at how you think something may not have that much sugar, but you'll find it has an incredible amount of grams of sugar. Things like iced tea, I see 50 grams of sugar. Number five, exercise daily, mix it up with interval and circuit training. Six, great movements, simple movements to strengthen the core are planks, side planks, and also the stability ball. So again, you can find a lot of this information on how to do these movements on muscleandfitness.com, on shape.com. They have great websites. They're great magazines. And again, to also inspire, motivate, and educate you in regards to getting started and maintaining a positive, healthy lifestyle. So stay focused, motivate, surround yourself with positive, healthy, like-minded people to get you to reach your goals. And remember to make it happen. We'll be right back. This is Rob Fletcher, ANGT Radio, 93.5 WTBQ.
When my business got bigger, many things changed. My lunches got shorter, more meetings arranged, my budget got bigger. But all that it meant was I cared even more about how it was spent. When I spend it on radio, I see where it goes. My investment comes back, and my business just grows. Radio helps all businesses to grow. Find out how at RadioHeardHere.com.
Brought to you by this radio station to remind you that radio is heard here. Radio is heard everywhere.
Oh, where to start in a health food store? Start with the herbs, like Mom Nature did. And you can learn all about medicinal herbs with me, Marguerite Dunn, the Urban Herbalist, Sunday from noon to 12:30 on WTBQ.
Hi, this is Rob McClain. Join me for the WTBQ News all day long on AM 1110 and 93.5 FM WTBQ. Covering the Hudson Valley and northern New Jersey, your source for local news, it's WTBQ News.
WTBQ Weather.
We could have a stray shower around this evening, then turning out partly to mostly cloudy tonight. Some patchy fog as we head towards morning. Now clouds, some periods of sunshine tomorrow. More numerous showers and thunderstorms in the afternoon, some with rather heavy downpours as highs reach the mid to upper 80s. And for Thursday, partly sunny and looking hotter with a high of 85 to 90. And we still can't rule out a shower or storm. From the WTBQ Weather Center, I'm meteorologist Mike Mahalik.
WTBQ. Hello and welcome back to ANGT Radio, America's next great trainer. I'm your host, Rob Fletcher, 93.5 WTBQ. You were listening to some Chris Miller advice and tips. And then we had some empowering songs by Whitney Houston and Mariah Carey. Again, just trying to get that mindset on a positive note and to get you to the next step to achieve your goals, whatever they may be. But again, to continue on with some healthy tips and advice, I'm just going to reading through some magazine here, Muscle and Fitness and Shape. And I'm just going to give you some do's and don'ts. Here we have... eat some do's. Eat whole grain foods like whole wheat, brown rice, and popcorn. Digest slowly and keep you feeling full. Snack on asparagus, a natural diuretic. This veggie helps you beat the bloat. And some don'ts, of course, if you're trying to cut back on the weight on the food intake, or if you're trying to lose weight, less alcohol the better. Drink less alcohol. drinking alcohol has empty calories and lowers inhibitions anyway, which could cause overeating. Eat processed, this is the don'ts, eat processed foods, refined products cause spikes in blood sugar and leave you feeling hungrier. Don't starve yourself. Remember, food is fuel. People have this idea that I want to lose 10 pounds, so I'm just not going to eat, where that's the wrong thing to do, because most likely what's going to happen is you'll go for a short period of time, then you'll either binge or you're definitely going to deprive yourself, and you will not have the energy needed to go throughout the course of the day. So not eating is not a good thing. You want to fuel your body with the right foods and also things that are low in fat. And I think it's also very important, as we said earlier, that you want to make it a habit to read the ingredients, also to know just to have a brief understanding of the different types of fats and what exactly it is you're eating. For example, saturated fats and unsaturated fats, saturated parts of fats. These are the biggest dietary cause of high LDL levels, the bad cholesterol. When looking at a food label, pay very close attention to the percentage of saturated fat and avoid or limit any foods that are high. Saturated fat should be limited to 10% of calories. Saturated fats are found in animal products such as butter, cheese, whole milk, ice cream, cream, and fatty meats. They're also found in vegetable oils, coconut, palm, and palm kernel oils. Most other vegetable oils contain unsaturated fat and are healthy. So that was saturated fats. Then you have unsaturated fats, fats that help to lower blood cholesterol if used in place of saturated fats. However, unsaturated fats have a lot of calories, so you still need to limit them. Most, but not all, liquid vegetable oils are unsaturated. The exceptions include coconut, palm, and palm kernel oils. These are two types of unsaturated fats, monounsaturated fats and polyunsaturated fats. Monounsaturated fats include olive and canola oils, and polyunsaturated fats, some examples include fish, sunflower, corn, and soybean oils. So again, you want to pay attention to what you're putting into your body, and there are side effects, of course, that you should be aware of. For example, eating too much saturated fat is one of the major risks of heart disease. A diet high in saturated fat causes soft, waxy substance called cholesterol to build up in the arteries. Too much fat also increases the risk of heart disease because of its high calorie content, which increases the chance of becoming obese, another risk factor of heart disease and some types of cancer. So again, fueling your body, paying attention to what you're eating, and also you want to make sure, the younger the better, educating your children on what they're eating and how they're fueling their bodies is very, very important. And I hope you enjoyed our show. I look forward to speaking with you next Tuesday. This is Rob Fletcher, ANGT Radio, America's Next Great Trainer, 93.5 WTBQ. Strive for your personal best. Go for that one moment in time. Be the Olympian you can be. Make it happen. Rob Fletcher, WTBQ 93.5, ANGT Radio.